ever boss represent for the Stargazing Show with your host, Shaun Cain. No, no, it got ready. Shaun, drop your thing, no man. Oi, go. Watch it, pray.
The realest online interview show, Stargazing with Shaun Cain, brings you up close and personal with your favorite stars of reggae and dancehall music and people that have impacted society in a very significant way.
When mama said to me, say, hurrah, it boy, me son, your boss. Me said, no, mama, me only a slow leak.
Join me, Shaun Cain, on the Stargazing with Shaun Cain YouTube channel as we check out the people behind the music. Learn who and what inspired them to write, record, and play some of the biggest records that have changed our lives forever. Find out why they have dedicated themselves to making the world a better place. Come on and let's retrace the mysterious twists and turns of their life journeys and browse some of the most inspirational backstories of all time. We invite you to subscribe to the Stargazing with Shaun Cain YouTube channel, like and share our videos, and leave a comment as we bring you fresh content every week. The Stargazing with Shaun Cain show will inspire, educate, and bring out the best in you. Stargazing with Shaun Cain, up close and personal.
Hello and welcome to Stargazing, the show that brings you up close and personal with your favorite stars of reggae and dancehall music, Jamaican popular culture, and people who've impacted society in a very big way. I'm Shaun Cain. In this edition of the show, we'll speak with reggae artiste Pressure Busspipe. Let's take a look. Pressure Busspipe is one of the US Virgin Islands' biggest and best-known musical exports. He is a righteous singer who has fully embraced reggae music. Born Delyno Brown in the early 1980s in the capital city of the island, St. Thomas, Pressure Busspipe was exposed to the music of Jamaica when he was still a very young child. He paid very close attention to the constant servings of righteousness that reggae delivered. The singer said he felt a natural connection with the music as it depicted life without glossy pictures. Pressure Busspipe boasts that his father was a member of a popular local reggae band and he used to admire his dad's works. As he watched his father perform, Pressure Busspipe eventually began to feel the urge to get involved as an artist. He originally started out as a drummer, but since finding his voice, he retired his drumsticks and hi-hats. The singer points out that as he received his appointment from Jah as a singer, he realized that he was chosen to write and perform conscious lyrics that motivate humanity. Pressure Busspipe released his Love and Affection album in 2007 with the title track Finding Fame due to the deep emotions it stirred among the lovers of reggae music. 2 years later, the singer published his Coming Back to You album. Not long afterwards, the sound followed. Again, the St. Thomas native showed he is a vocal powerhouse. His Virgin Islands Nice record caught the attention of the island's tourism department, which used the song as the backdrop of an extensive marketing campaign to attract visitors to the U.S. Virgin Islands. As Pressure Busspipe continued to build his repertoire, he released the African Redemption album, which featured international star Chronix. His next album, Red Rose, rocked and released its attention-grabbing fragrance all the way onto the Billboard Reggae Album Chart, where it peaked at number 8. The singer's latest album, Heights of Greatness, which was released in August this year, has been widening the Rastafarian artist's fan base around the globe. Pressure Busspipe received the Caribbean American Movers and Shaker Award for International Artist of the Year in 2017. The Atlanta, USA-based singer and his father, Irwin Brownie Brown, were honored by the U.S. Virgin Islands Senate in 2018 for their musical contributions.
When they see, they don't know what it really means. Neglecting the powers of the Isle of Trinity, dispensing corruption against our identity. I have burned all spies and the conspiracies. I have burned all scribes and evil Pharisees.
Welcome back. Pressure, what go on, sir?
Well, go on, King. Big up, big up.
I'm good, man. I'm good. What's the Virgin Islands like now, man?
Man, Virgin Islands nice, you know.
So what makes it so nice?
Is it the weather?
You know, the beautiful atmosphere, man, is like, you know what I mean? The warm weather, well, the hot weather, and of course, the beautiful beaches and stuff like that, you know what I mean? Lovely people. It's a beautiful place. Always nice.
Lovely, lovely. Like to hear that. Well, that's a big advert for the tourist board, you know, so they have to pay for that.
Cool, no man.
Well, you know what? You must have enjoyed quite a bit of that because lockdown was a long and dark period, especially for entertainers. No work, no shows, nothing like that. How did you cope during those times?
Well, I mean, I don't live on the island. I live in Atlanta, Georgia. So for me, I was locked in the house and creating music still. You know, that was more than ever. You know what I mean? Creating music, being that I wasn't on the road and doing shows, I had more time to make music, you know? But of course, it's been a damp on the industry to not be able to go out there and perform as we need to help sustain us, you know what I mean? So, it has been one of a kind. Yeah,
that's very good, man. For an artist, you know, to be sitting there just writing and recording, that's good because you're building up. So that last time, you know, you've got things open up, then, you know, you've got lots of work to go and share with the people. But what would you say is the single biggest thing that you learned during lockdown? Because I would imagine there must be a lesson in that.
Well, for me, the lesson is that you can't depend on anything, really. You got to find, you got to have multiple streams of income. You know, you can't really be just about one thing. You know, you have to improvise. You know, it really teach me. I mean, I come up in a time when there wasn't really social media and all of that. You know what I mean? So it's like I went through a time when we had hurricanes in the Virgin Islands and you know what I mean? We really couldn't go anywhere because there's no place to go. You know, houses are messed up and the streets are mashed up and everywhere is like it totally devastated. So, you know, I've been through that over and over on the island, you know what I mean? So being on lockdown and not being able to go to the supermarket and certain things like that is like, you know what I mean? It's something I could really deal with too, not for too long, but, you know, it withstand me. It's something that I was prepared for as well, you know.
All right, that's good, man. You had some practice. The hurricanes really brought you up. But now that things are opening up, countries are opening up, shows are starting again, stadia, arenas, and different music venues are opening up, and they're booking artists again. I mean, how are things looking for you? Anything lined up yet?
Things are looking very good right now. I just, since things have opened up, I've probably did at least 4 shows so far. And since the album released the other day, I've gotten a lot of responses for shows and stuff like that. You know, especially we're also putting together tours for 2022 as well. You know what I mean? But definitely a lot of phone calls been coming in for shows thus far.
So have you got anything confirmed yet? Like, you know, you're going to be in Europe in this time or you're going to be in South America?
Well, I can't give you a date, but I know for sure Europe, we have big plans for a tour in Europe in 2022, you know, so that's definite as far as our planning goes, you know, but as far as the way the world is running right now, you know, we just have to play it by ear. But as far as the planning is definitely in making for Pressure Busspipe to tour Europe. And Africa as well for 2022. You know, this year I think we're gonna do more off dates and, you know, not so much a heavy touring and stuff like that. But yes, I'm looking forward to all of it. Give thanks.
I can just imagine, man. I can just imagine you've got some righteous music that you put together during lockdown and you've got those to unleash on the people. But talking about righteous music though, there seems to be a trend nowadays where, especially from the Rasta community, that righteousness seems to be waning. What do you think? Do you think that's a fair observation or not in your estimation?
Well, I believe that, you know, Rastafari is one's way of life and stuff like that. And then you have entertainers that choose to entertain the people and not so much be traditionally pushing out the Rastafari thing. As for me, you know, Rastafari is something I want to push to the forefront. So I use the music to do that, you know. So I can't really speak much for other artists, but, within myself, I feel like it's a responsibility. Even being what you just said, knowing that, you know, it's not much of it right now, and not much of the hardcore righteousness spreading in the music, you know, basically only from selective artists, you know. But it's just growth in some artists feeling like, you know, they want to be a part of what's popping with the younger generation, and being able to bridge that gap as well, between people just seeing you as this holy figure and this spiritual reggae artist or whatever. You know, I think that showing another side of you, linking with the younger generation and doing music that they could relate to, bridges the gap somehow, you know what I mean? And still, you know, you could actually insert the teachings within that as well, but don't get too churchical with it, you know what I mean? Just keep it on a level where it's like, okay, we could relate to that and it really makes sense, you know? For everyone, they find direction, you know? I know when to tame my churchical ardor and when to rise it high, you know what I mean? Because it's all part of entertainment, you know. But I do realize and recognize that that hardcore message where you would hear it coming from four corners of the industry, you know, it's very thin right now, you know. So if you look within the thin part of it, I want to be amongst that, you know, the little that the industry gets when it comes to the righteous music and the uplifting music, you know, I want to be amongst the chosen few, you know. Mm-hmm. So I don't get weary with what the rest of the world are going with and what's popping, and you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It's really the teachings, and I think that somehow people could easily forget that, getting lost into the music that just makes you feel good and makes you want to dance and enjoy yourself tonight and have a drink and dance with a woman and thing like that. You know, besides that, I think that people really need to a source to be able to turn to for that kind of music. As if you would need a doctor when you're sick and you know, only the doctor can cure certain things, or only the herbalist can cure certain things. You would use him in times of need. I want to be that artist that the people can rely on. When you hear Pressure Busspipe, you know, say, all right, clean music. This is what I want to hear on a Sunday afternoon. This is what I want to hear when I just want to get my mind right and think, you know what I mean? Because a lot of people have so much things going on, you know, they don't want to think. They just want to, like, just take their mind far away from the problems and the stress. So they listen to stuff that just make them feel happy for no one. Something that's going to take them away from all the problems and the stress. Reggae music brings the problems to the forefront and your stress to the forefront. So, you know what I mean? It's like you can't run from yourself when you are listening to reggae music. So a lot of people, you know, especially with the conscious and the righteous music, it could be too in-depth for the masses. You know, and then there's a few who is like, yo, I like it just like that, you know. So being an entertainer, I have to be able to balance between everybody and make everybody feel good, and, you know, and that's just me.
So how do you balance that then? If it's all about righteousness versus the opposite of righteousness, do you sometimes project the opposite of righteousness to balance it? How do you balance it? You've got people who are busy telling how to shoot people, people who are busy telling you how to go and scam people, people who are telling you how to go and rob people, and then you're coming with a righteous bit now, and you're saying you've got to balance it to appeal to all these different audiences. How do you appeal to an audience that's expecting you to tell them to go and rob people? How do you do it?
Yeah, well, to be honest with you, that's not my kind of balance, you know what I mean? Okay. That's not where I see balance, you know. That's like you totally drop off of the ledge with right. What you're talking about. Mm-hmm. That's not my kind of balance. My balance is like having fun with the music. I might want to sing a calypso song, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? And I might want to tell people how I feel like just getting away and partying and enjoying myself tonight. That's not telling people to go and kill one another. That's balancing what the people, the younger generation, can relate to, separate from them just hearing about the gun violence, you know, because the young people don't just listen to that. There's a wide range of music that they listen to and uplift them, you know what I mean? But people love artists for what they bring to the table, you know, because I don't expect for somebody to listen to me all day, every day, every day. I have my favorite artists and I don't listen to them every day. I want to hear what's out there and what carries a new feel that could inspire me to keep doing my thing. You know what I mean? So balance for me is just having fun with the music, you know, even if you want to get violent in the music, make it be a lyrical violent. You know what I mean? Make it be something that we could more look at it like, look, he's wicked with lyrics. His lyrics is bad. Versus me thinking like, yo, who is he talking about? Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, that's how it was in the older days. Like, if I tell you, you know what I mean? My lyrics is like faster than a computer and me, I go kill you with the lyrics out of the speaker. And them was violent in lyrical form. You know what I mean? But today, it's a lot more expressive.
Yeah, you know? It's moved away from that play up on words to become a reality. They're living it. They're doing it.
Exactly.
Because you use the word bad in it, and bad, as we know, is bad. You say kill or murder or what, that means all killing is all bad. But the way you use it, it's a spin you put on it. Bad it's is meaning that this is really a nice piece of joke, or I'm going to murder a sound boy. Not necessarily a person, but the sound, you know, that music.
And we understood that.
I'm going to do better than that.
We understood that coming from the sound culture. You know what I mean? That's a part of the sound culture. But then now, you know, the people expression living in the communities where this is all they see. Mm-hmm. You know, for me, I come from a bad community as well, but I wasn't poor. I didn't come from a poor community, but I came from a community that didn't need to portray certain things. It was all what they saw on TV, and they didn't have the support from mommy and daddy, so this is what it came to. But my community wasn't a starving and a poor community where we don't have nothing. Everybody was going to school. You know, we have basketball courts and in the community. We had a center where we had computers and stuff. So it was just the thinking of the people. You know what I mean? So it's the way, it's what you put your mind to and really elevate from what you see every day happening. Me, I've seen stuff, but what I got out of it is what I want people to learn different from what I've seen. You know, some people are just raw with, they want you to see what they've seen. You know, they want you to feel what they go through. You know what I mean? So that's not the way the Most High appointed me to deliver his message. You know what I mean? But for other people, that's their way. You know, because in this life, we can't, there's a positive and a negative. And I couldn't be this positive without seeing the negative or being through the negative firsthand. You know what I mean? To know like, all right, cool, I've seen enough. It's time to really change things. You know what I mean? Every youth at some point in their life, they will or they should find that breaking point where it's like, you know what? I've created a lot of havoc. Mm-hmm. Right now, it's time to really
turn a different corner.
Turn the table. You know, a lot of youths are just doing things because that's a way out. You know, I might not be a bad man, but bad man sang around the place and the record labels are signing artists with bad man lyrics. So I need a bad man sang because I'm great. I'm very talented. I'm not talking about me, you know. Just picture
me becoming
artist and just need that recognition. You know what I mean? I need that recognition. I need somebody to pay attention to Pressure Busspipe. I am going to sing whatever the crowd is going to go crazy for right now, because I need that. You know what I mean? I don't necessarily have to be a bad man. The people will figure that out later on. But right,
you will now, achieve your objective from it by getting the forward and getting your to trend, getting your music on the chart and your number one and getting shows.
Definitely. You know what I mean? So for me now, I came with a different approach with the music. I never came with the approach like I wanted to prove anything to anybody.
That you know,
it's like I have a talent. Mm-hmm. I like to sing music this way. This is what I like to do. And I'm going to do it, you know. And if you want to work with me, we're going to work together. I've never been signed to a record label. I've never encouraged my management team to go look a deal for me. I've always been comfortable in my freedom to create music, which I've always been free to create music from the time from my first working with Dan Carleon up until this day. You know what I mean?
Pressure. Has that freedom made you a lot of money?
It's made me comfortable. You know, it's made me comfortable. I've never considered myself to be rich, you know, and I don't think I've made a lot of money like my other peers in the industry who, you know, who make a lot more money for a show and stuff like that. You know, I just work, you know, I just do my thing and continue to, you know, whatever, if it's a small venue and I feel like, you know, I'm never too big to perform in a venue that only carries 150 people or 200 people. You know, I would find ways to be reasonable with the promoter so that I could be available for that crowd. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I'm not the artist that is like, oh, no, just find a different venue because they're too small and the little money there. And I'm always trying to work it out because for me is the message. If Jah appoint me, Jah never appoint me to go collect wally pa money. And call him appoint me to go spread the message.
You know what? I'm going to come in at that point because there was a question going on in my head because you made a very interesting point there when you said Jah appointed you to be a music ambassador of a certain sort. The issue with me is that I don't think a lot of these artists feel that they've been appointed to be music ambassadors. I think they're just hustling and they just think, I just want a big break. I just want to make a million. I just want to drive a nice car and all, which nothing is wrong with. But I just think, what's your appointment? And I like the point you made about your appointment. I think they should think about the appointment and then they will stay true to that appointment.
Yes. Yes. You know what I mean? And a lot
of you get that idea from, Pressure? Where did you get that idea from? That's appointed you.
It couldn't be me alone. I didn't come up with this idea that I'm just going to spread positivity. It came from a higher source, you know, and it's a feeling within that, you know, I know this is what I have to do, you know, versus, you know, because and the people make me feel this way. The reward from the people, what they say is like, listen, continue spreading the message. I'm inspired by your music. I get this every day. For years, I've been getting that. So that alone in itself is inspiration for me to continue and know that I'm here for a purpose. You know what I mean? So that's why I continue with that. I never got a lot of recognition from songs that I did other than reggae music and stuff that, you know what I mean? Well, I did from the soca song, but most of my songs that I step out the box and I'm having fun with, people are like, yeah, Pressure, we like, you know, you're very creative and you're versatile and stuff like this, but this is what we like. Yeah. This is what we like from Pressure. So I have to be able to always deliver that, you know?
We're going to take a quick break, Pressure. Very good point there, which I'm going to come back to. You're watching The Stargazing with Shaun Cain Show. Our very special guest is Pressure Busspipe, a man who hails from the US Virgin Islands. We're going to take a quick break. We'll be back shortly.
Hi everyone, this is Sean Reese, and I'm representing for the Stargazing Show with your boy Shaun Cain, featuring artists from around the world. See? So hit that subscribe button, that notification bell. See?
I will never break my virgin stone. I know you, Lord, and I will stand my ground. You are the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So the fire keeps blazing. Well, red.
Stargazing.
The realest online interview show, Stargazing with Shaun Cain, brings you up close and personal with your favorite stars of reggae and dancehall music and people that have impacted society in a very significant way.
When mama said to me, say, hurrah, it boy, me son, your boss. Me said, no, mama, me only a slow leak.
Join me, Shaun Cain, on the Stargazing with Shaun Cain YouTube channel as we check out the people behind the music. Learn who and what inspired them to write, record, and play some of the biggest records that have changed our lives forever. Find out why they have dedicated themselves to making the world a better place. Come on and let's retrace the mysterious twists and turns of their life journeys and browse some of the most inspirational backstories of all time.
Thank you, God.
We invite you to subscribe to the Stargazing with Shaun Cain YouTube channel, like and share our videos, and leave a comment as we bring you fresh content every week. The Stargazing with Shaun Cain show will inspire, educate, and bring out the best in you. Stargazing with Shaun Cain, up close and personal.
Yo, a relevant boss I represent for the Stargazing show with your host, Shaun Cain. No, no, it got ready. Shaun, drop your thing, no man. How you go? Watch it, pray. Boom!
Welcome back to the Stargazing with Shaun Cain show, where we're speaking with Pressure Busspipe. Pressure, you alluded earlier to some of the grimy side of the music and what some of these artists have experienced in their own communities. My issue is, if they've seen their loved ones being killed in front of them or being maimed, you know, through violence and gunshots and things like those, why do they continue to sing about it?
Because it's a process of not being healed, you know, in the ghetto communities, you know what I mean? It's an ongoing village of just, you know, revenge and remorse and stuff like that. And is happening before my time. It's happening in my time. You know what I mean? And then there's forces in the ghetto, like who even the Christians or even the Rastafarians who want to seek goodness and mercy and stuff like that. You know what I mean? And it's just for them to, it's not really cool to do like positive. You're just always positive. Is the cool thing to do is like, yo, I'm gonna deal with certain thing, you know, yo, I'm a bad man, you know. And that's the cool in the ghetto, you know.
But Pressure, why that is cool? They are looking at, they remember their brother was murdered. They remember that their cousin is now in a wheelchair because they've got a bullet in their spine. When they sing about, you know, go and do this to people, go and shoot this, do they reflect on those events in their lives and realize that that instrument called the gun has brought me a lot of pain because I cried for my dead brother. I'm now crying for my cousin. Can't do anything, can't move around on his own. People have to help him. But I'm still singing about go and shoot people. What's going on? Yeah. I don't get that bit. I can't live
like that, a hypocritical life also. You know what I mean? It's very hypocritical because I know a lot of the artists are not that way in real life. You know what I mean? Even if they come from ghetto communities, I know that they really, at the stage they're at as artists right now, they really don't want to harm anybody and be in no gun violence with none. They want to live a happy life. They want to get rich. They want to buy cars and have lots of money and have a big house. That's the life they really want to live. Nobody wants to live that violent life. But the streets are buying it. You know, that's what the streets want. And that's what they're providing for the streets. They're providing that relative effect. Like, yo, we could relate to what he's talking about. And it's just a cycle of not being healed happening over and over and over.
But you see,
a lot of people.
Sorry to cut in there, Pressure. But the irony of that is when the street is reeling for that, because the street really wants that, but the street is living it. And when you create that kind of system whereby you feed the people with their minds with this kind of music, they become violent and they want to rob you as well. When you've made your big money and you've made lots of money, you live on the hill and you've got your big house and you've got lots of lovely, expensive cars. They want to rob you because you fed that to them. So how does that work? Who is benefiting then?
Well, they're the one benefiting from the shows and the streamings and all of that, you know. And
where do they live to enjoy the money? If you're living in the wild, wild west, because everybody's a Billy the Kid.
A lot of them live no artist is dying. Nobody's killing artists. It's the people in the streets are dying. You understand what I'm saying? They're the one who are getting the bad end of the stick. You know, it's the uneducated who are not seeing the artists as being creative and just having fun with lyrics and stuff like that and taking it so literal. They're the ones who feeling the bad end of the stick. You know, the artist, of course, should know what he's doing and project things that he wants for himself through the music, of course. You know what I mean? But in a industry where we know dancehall music came from an era of battling and, you know, and hip hop came from that same foundation is like, it is always been that. It has always been competition and, you know, murder sound and, you know, this MC against this MC. It's a long culture of it. You know what I mean? Bounty Killer and Beanie Man were the greatest rivals in the industry. And God know behind the scenes they were friends. You know what I mean? But it was something that they needed to keep their thing going and keep the fans in into them by knowing, like, look, when Beanie Man put out a song, it had this Bounty Killer, this Beanie Man. Sting come is a big thing. But you know what I mean? And they keep up the persona out of road and Ray. And I'm not saying that they never got into anything personal, but it never reached murder. Mm-hmm. It never reached where you hear people like get killed and shot a fire after kill and Beanie Man can't go. Yeah. So to the fans, it was all fun and joy. Even if Beanie get boo or Bounty Killer get boo, it was just that. You know what I mean? It was just that. Yeah, you get boo because we like him today. Mm. You know what I mean? And tomorrow we might like you more. But it's the uneducated fans, you know, that don't have the sense to know that this is just musical. Mm. This is just musical, you know? But you could blame the artist because it starts with him. He's the one that puts out the energy.
Mm. You know, but so for me... Do you ever feel a bit tempted to bust a few bad boy tunes just to show that?
What do you mean? I have bad boy songs in my computer right now. My friends be begging me to release them. I would never release them.
Why?
Because that's not who Pressure is.
But why did you record them then?
Because I was having fun and it's not for the world to hear this.
Oh, that's your private fun.
This is for me to sharpen my sword and sharpen my thing, because it's like Rastafari now. We're loving people, you know, but we're lions and we're warriors as well. We defend
for right. You have to, because sometimes the violence is brought to you, so you have to stand up and defend.
You never know. I might just be in a fun thing off with an artist, like me and an artist having a fun combination, and you know, we're having a rivalry and I might need some lyrics to kill him because he might have them put on already.
Killing, so killing as what you understood killing to be when you were growing up.
Not the one now. You know, I might need to murder him lyrically.
Yes.
So I have my lyrics put aside, but it's not for the world, for me to push out badness to the world. There's enough for that, you know. So I wouldn't contribute to it more than contribute to what the world really needs, you know, which is very little, which is the conscious music, which is the uplifting music. I contribute to that more because, you know, it's like you make something for drink and it's like, it don't have no sugar. It don't have nothing, it just, you know.
It's bland.
You want to add some more. Mm. Yeah, it's boring, you know, so it's just that.
All right, talk to me a little bit about your Rastafarian beliefs and how did you get involved in that kind of movement?
Well, in my community, in St. Thomas, Rastafari was big in my community. My mom and my dad is not Rastafari. You know, my grandmother, who raised 11 children, six of them were Rasta. My aunts and uncles are Rasta. You know, so I grew up in a community where it's easy to be into that culture. Friends, Rasta, you know, in my community, we would always have, like, we'd be bubbling Yaba pots and Ital pots on the court and stuff like that. So, and the reggae music and Dennis Brown and stuff like that. Like the only thing I knew about Christianity was my grandmother, because she would take us to church like at least once a month. You know, she would take us from our mother and be like, okay, this weekend I'm going to take him to church and next weekend I'm going to take him to church. That's the only way I knew about church. But every day it was like I'm in contact with the Rasta culture and the movement, you know. And
Did it feel strange being in church?
Yeah, it always felt strange, you know, because it was very proper and, you know, I couldn't relate a lot of the stuff that I was learning in the church to my everyday life. you know, in the ghetto and stuff like that. You know, it was just, everything was, for me, was, you know, candy coated and, you know, with a suit and a tie, you know what I mean? It wasn't teaching me about the afflictions and the inflictions on us as a people. It was more teaching me to be passive and to not ask questions, you know, just, you know, it was just that for me. And Rastafari.
Just submit to whatever comes to you.
Yeah, if submit to whatever comes to you. That kind of, yeah. You know, so I wasn't able to ask a lot of questions because in that it was like, you know, you don't question God. Everything, God works in mysterious ways, you know. And
so did you have a problem? Did you have a problem with that?
I internally did, you know. My heart wasn't connected to the church, you know. My heart was connected to just being free and being a young boy and just doing whatever my friends wanted to do. And, you know, I was never into robbing and stealing and into badness and stuff like that as a youth. But my friends were always mischievous and into stuff, you know. So my mother would, like, call me home regular. She'd be like, listen, come home, because I don't see, you know, you're about to get yourself into some problems. So just come home, you know. And even elders on the community would send me home, you know what I mean? Because my family was very popular and I was that one young youth in the community where it's like, I guess to everybody, I had an ambition, you know? I seemed to be like I was more into school and trying to become something. Because my parents always had me involved in activities. I was playing Little League. I was in learning to play the steel drum, you know? I was, every summer I would be in a summer program learning how to sail boats or maybe using computers or flying plane. You know, my parents always had me active. Even though I was living in an underprivileged community, we weren't poor. You know what I mean? My mother was working with the government. My father had like 5 jobs. He was basically hustling, doing everything, working on the radio station. He was a taxi driver. You know, he would MC shows in the night. He was doing everything to make money. So I had means to get things done. So they were very strict with me versus my friends. Like my friends, they used to be out late at night, you know, and I used to be like, why I can't stay outside? And my mom would be like, nah, you stay in here. Like they were more strict with me versus my peers' parents. You know what I mean?
Right.
So Rastafari, you know, was easy for me because I already had a certain divinity about myself, and I was already a humble youth. I used to listen a lot to people. I used to pay attention to a lot of stuff that was going on around, and you know, I always used to pick the good out of everything and always try to find something to do positive with myself. I was always a sharing person, like, you know, because I was blessed. My mother and my father worked hard. So I would always get my little sneakers and, you know, anything I want. So if I get little money, I would go and buy candy and share candy amongst my friends. And, you know, I was always that youth that, you know, my friends would always used to come and beg a 50 cent. Can I hold a dollar? You know what I mean?
Yeah, so you're always sharing then, even though
I was always that youth, you know what I mean? Because my parents were always giving. I was always, like my cousins would always say I was spoiled. You know, I'm my mother's first child, so she would spoil me with every little thing I want. But when it comes to schoolwork, it's like I have to be doing great.
Yeah, there's no negotiation in that.
There's no negotiation.
You won't have it your way.
Yeah.
But you said you were always ambitious then, Pressure. What did you want to do when you were growing up? Did you always want to be a musician?
Drummer.
Wanted to be a musician?
Yes, I always wanted to be a musician.
Not a doctor, not a lawyer, not a teacher, nothing.
Well, I wanted to play baseball. That was a small dream of mine. I, you know, playing Little League and, you know, everybody around is my peers and my cousins are playing and stuff. And I really thought I was going to probably go to the major leagues or something. You know, at that time, we had a lot of scouts in the Virgin Islands looking at players because we have quite a few players from the Virgin Islands who played in the major leagues. So we would have scouts coming to our little league games and we would have little clinics and stuff with major league players. So I was always involved in that. And I it wasn't until I got cut from an all-star team that I realized, like, you know, this probably isn't for me. Because I was juggling between music, baseball, and I was really good at music. And all my friends, you know, they would probably tell me, like, you know, you could play baseball good, but you're really good at music. You should probably pursue music.
So were you disappointed when you didn't get drafted for the majors?
Yes, man. Yes, man. Because me want nobody tell me that I'm good at this and I'm not good at that. You know what I mean? And I started to feel like it was a sort of favoritism, you know, and it was just that. But I soon came to realize, like, it was all part of my journey, you know, to get me to focus on what I needed to really focus on.
Mm-hmm. No. So music now, recording, how did that start? What was your first move towards a career in music? Did you knock up a producer and say, hey, I'm good at singing, do you want to record me? Or did you just start to write? I mean, how did that come about?
For me, like, I was a drummer in high school. I would always listen. I was listening to a lot of, you know, Sizzla and Capleton, Anthony B, you know, Dennis Brown. I would always listen to a lot of, like, real hardcore culture reggae music. You know, this is like back in 1996 97, you know. And but I was failing in school, you know. I wasn't doing well in school at all, you know. I was doing very good in music. Like, my report card was, you know, A plus in music, and I would have like D and F in all my other subjects. I was getting myself into a lot of problems in high school now. Like, it's like adolescence. So now I'm like hanging with my friends a lot more, and I'm getting into gang fights in school and defending my community, and just following company, you know. So there was a time when I was being suspended from school, maybe every 2 months. I was getting into a fight in school and being suspended, and it reached a point I was going to be expelled from school. So my mother, she decided to send me away to live with my uncle in America. And my uncle told me, you know, like, he started me off playing music and stuff like that. And he asked of me of certain things, and I disobeyed him through the journey. You know, I was burning, I was smoking ganja and stuff from back in St. Thomas. So that same kind of energy I brought to Atlanta, and my uncle wasn't having it, you know. So when he asked me not to do it anymore, you know, I stopped for a minute, you know. And being that I was popular in school because I came from the islands and stuff like that, you know, a lot of friends in the school, they were asking me like, yo, what you know about ganja? You smoke ganja? You smoke that good pot? You know what I mean? So, of course, I'm defending it. Like, yeah, of course. How you talk about weed? Of course you smoke weed. So now me have to defend it. So now, you know, lunchtime come and they asking me if I want to come and smoke with them. And I'm doing that. And, you know, one time my uncle, he smelled it on me. And that was it. He took me out of music. I couldn't play the drums. I couldn't do any of that anymore. You know, I just had to focus on my academics, and not only music. I couldn't even come out the house anymore. I was basically grounded for a long time. I couldn't even come outside and shoot hoops by the garage.
It was how did you cope with that period in your life?
No, it was hard. It was hard.
What did you do to pass the time?
I started to write. This was the moment when I started to write music. You know, I mean, there was nothing more musical I could do but just write.
Right.
At the time, I was already known for singing other people's songs. I would sing, you know, a Shabba Ranks. I could sound like Bounty Killer when I feel like I could mimic artists. A lot of my friends used to like to hear me sing other people's music because I would try to sound exactly like them, you know. So I already had a feel of how to deliver music, you know. And I just started to write music. And one day I went to school and they had this little, you know, during lunchtime, they had these couple artists, they were like battling with one another and everybody was huddling around. So I went over there and I was watching them and I just jump in and I sing a Sean Paul song. You know what I mean? But nobody in the school know this Sean Paul. You know? At the time, Sean Paul
was... Which one was that?
It was No One, No One, No Bad. No One You Feel Violet and You Accelerate. Right? But nobody in the school knows this song because nobody's into reggae music. At the time, Sean Paul wasn't a huge superstar like he was, like he is now. You know what I mean? It was like in the earlys. I'm talking about this is 1997, 98, you know? And I sing that tune and they went crazy. So it's like they want to hear me sing again. So I have to run the same song again. At this time, I don't have no lyrics in them. So the youth, them, they was like, yo, man, we love that, man. Listen, we got this little studio down in our hood. You should come through, man. Let's do some recordings and stuff, man. I'm in high school, but I can't go nowhere because I'm grounded.
You're grounded.
My uncle, them, yeah, I can't go nowhere. So I would go home and ask my uncle. My uncle would be like, hell no, where? Down in the ghetto? No, man, I'm not taking you down there. For you to go back down there and smoke? No, man, you're not going to. You know what I mean?
Yes.
So it was just that until I brought my grades up. But during that time, bringing my grades up, I was writing music. And of course, linking with these youths in school every day and doing my thing with them. Until my uncle gave me the permission to go and visit them. He was like, listen, I'm giving you 1 hour. And I'm picking you right back up in 1 hour. And I recorded my first song. It was in the year 1998.
Right.
I recorded my first song. And it was a positive song. Mine, I was already listening to a lot of culture music and uplifting music. And the song, the ghetto youths crying out, can't you hear the complaint while the rich man have the money and the music campaign? When there's no food on the table, who is there to blame? Selassie, I may call out your name. Just like that, right? My first song I recorded. There's more lyrics, of course, but I got the CD, and when my uncle picked me up, pushed the CD in his deck in the car, and him hear it, and he's like, sound good, man, sound good. Sound good, you know?
So you get a forward from him.
You get a forward from him, you know what I mean? But, so now it's like, I want to go back to the studio some more, and he's like, nah, I gave you a chance, you know? Like, so now I have the vibe, my grades is up, you know, I'm doing better in school, now I'm feeling this vibe like I want to be an artist, like, you know, for some reason it's like, I'm liking this now, you know, I sent the CD back to the Virgin Islands to a couple of my friends, and they were like, yo, we love the way you sound, nah, you sound hard, you need to come back home.
This is dope, man.
Yeah, you know what I mean? So at this time now, I'm begging my mother, like, mom, like, my grades are up. I'm doing
talk
better.
Talk to uncle for me, please. Talk to uncle.
I mean, talk to uncle for me, please. And, you know, and my mother was like, all right, cool. I already, you know, your uncle been telling me your grades come up. So, you know, I told her, like, listen, I want to graduate in my high school in the Virgin Islands. Please, just do me that. I'll come home. I'm a better person. I'm doing better, you know. So she brought me back to the VI to
But hold on, Pressure. Before you go back to the VI, I want to find out, because you talked about writing when you were during lockdown, that uncle's imposed lockdown.
Yeah.
I wanted to find out what thoughts were going through your mind and what you were transferring onto paper during those periods when you couldn't go out with your friends, couldn't smoke anymore of that thing, and you couldn't hang out in the ghetto anymore. Tell me what you were thinking and writing.
I was writing all my pressures and my pains, you know what I mean? I was writing about Rastafari too, because at that time, I was heavily into the studies of learning about the culture of Rastafari. I didn't have any natty dreads or anything. I was still in high school, but that was the era when it was like a shining light for me. Like, I was picking up books, reading, was searching everywhere and to try to find new information about Rastafari. It was that much for me, even so that I was educating people in the school in America about it, those that were interested to learn about me, you know, and my culture. Not so much they wanting to learn about Rastafari, but if you want to learn about me, you're going to learn about who this man is, Haile Selassie. So, you know, it was a lot of pressure I was putting on paper, you know.
No, but when you talked about the pain, you were writing about your pain. What kind of pain was that?
Pain of not being able to be free and be who I want to be right now. Pain of of wanting to just blossom right now and not be held down by my uncles, you know, and, you know, just ready to just be someplace else, you know what I mean?
So were you cussing your uncle in them lyrics?
No, not really, you know. Not really, you know. But it's like translated into the pressures that Rastafari faced and me learning about the whole culture and stuff like that. It was a lot for me, you know. And even living with my uncle, I'm so grateful for that too, because I learned so much at that time as to how to be responsible, you know, as a man and stuff like that. It really taught me a lot, you know, and I'm even looking back, I'm forever grateful for those days. You know?
I thought so too, because, you know, he was playing the role of a dad, because yes. He was really keen on you doing well, keen on you being away from bad influences, which is exactly. Kind of what a dad does.
Yes.
And he definitely. Was serious. I'm giving you 1 hour and I'm coming back to pick you up in an hour. And he was there. Instead of saying, you know, it's not my child, I'll forget about him, or I can go later on.
Definitely.
He was doing the job.
He saw my vision, and he definitely was there with me throughout the whole way. You know what I mean? Yes. Even when it was rough between both of us and he had to get down on me, bad, real, you know, it was like, I still could look back on it and be like, listen, those moments helped to curve the route I was going, you know.
Definitely.
Because when I came back to the Virgin Islands,
I was just about to ask you about that. As you mentioned, curve the route, I was thinking about, let's hear the route back to the Virgin Islands now. So you were reading my mind. Yeah, let's hear it now. So you've been brought back to the Virgin Islands now, because you pleaded to mom and she said yes, come home.
Yeah, so coming back to the Virgin Islands now, my mom and dad had separated, you know. So my dad had went on to live with find an apartment, and my mom had went to live with her mom, grandmother, right? So my godfather had passed away as well while I was living in Atlanta, living in Georgia, and he had willed a property to my mother, you know, a property with a small little wood house on the property. So coming back to the Virgin Islands to finish school, you know, my mother, who, you know, at that time even allowed me to smoke, you know, but just be respectful. And she was more afraid that I was out there and somebody would harm me when it comes to that. You know what I mean? But she never really was like 100% against it, you know? So coming back to the Virgin Islands and her knowing me, you know, and seeking Rastafari, and she decided she's going to let me stay at that property, you know, it was a small wood house, a one bedroom, one bathroom. And, I was going to school, you know, so me coming back to school now and trying to get my diploma, and, you know, right now I have bills to pay. I have a light bill and a water bill. You know, the rent was like $100, $125, which was still money that I had to come up with.
A lot of money. You know what I mean? Yeah.
And if I was short, my mother would help me out, or even my father. But they made it known that now it's time for me to be responsible, especially if I want to, you know, be a Rasta and do all of these stuff and think, okay, learn to support your own now, you know? So that was me in high school, you know, and going to school and coming home to my own place, you know, but my mother would wake me up every morning to make sure I was up for school, you know? And it was that. So now in school, I come back and a lot of my friends are hearing that I'm an artist now, and you know, I'm doing my thing, so I'm performing amongst my friends, and then there's some talent shows coming up, and I'm involved in the talent shows, and I'm gaining little popularity in the school and stuff, until everybody in the school now, who used to see me as a drummer, now see me as an artist. Like, I wasn't drumming anymore, completely had stopped drumming. All my dreams and aspirations of becoming a top drummer was now being a top artist. On this trip back to the Virgin Islands to finish high school. So, you know, it was that for me, and got a lot of recognition from my friends and peers and stuff like that, you know, and also it was a lot of pressure. And that is where I got my name, Pressure, you know.
What kind of pressure was this?
The pressures of trying to graduate and having to keep the light and the water bill paid, and still trying to pursue music on a high level, it was a lot of pressure. Of course, in the Virgin Islands, there's not much opportunities for music, you know, and my visions was way past what the Virgin Islands could offer, you know, and, you know, for me, it was like a lot of pressure because I didn't know what my future holds. All I knew is that this is what I really wanted to do. And by any means necessary, whatever I need to get it done, I'm going to do it.
Hi, everyone. This is Shaun Reese, and I'm representing for the Stargazing Show with your boy, Shaun Cain, featuring artists from around the world. See? So hit that subscribe button and notification bell. See?
I will never break my virgin stone. I know you, Lord, and I will stand my ground. You are the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So the fire keeps blazing. Well, red.
Stargazing Show.
The realest online interview show, Stargazing with Shaun Cain, brings you up close and personal with your favorite stars of reggae and dancehall music and people that have impacted society in a very significant way.
When mama said to me, say, hurrah, it boy, me son, your boss. Me said, no, mama, me only a slow leak.
Join me, Shaun Cain, on the Stargazing with Shaun Cain YouTube channel as we check out the people behind the music. Learn who and what inspired them to write, record, and play some of the biggest records that have changed our lives forever. Find out why they have dedicated themselves to making the world a better place. Come on and let's retrace the mysterious twists and turns of their life journeys and browse some of the most inspirational backstories of all time.
Thank you, God.
We invite you to subscribe to the Stargazing with Shaun Cain YouTube channel, like and share our videos, and leave a comment as we bring you fresh content every week. The Stargazing with Shaun Cain show will inspire, educate, and bring out the best in you. Stargazing with Shaun Cain, up close and personal.
So why did you go back to Atlanta?
I did.
You did?
After high school and graduating from high school, I was performing in a group called the Star Lion Family, and we were all artists. We weren't a band or anything, but we gained a lot of recognition opening shows for big acts. Our first concert was Sizzla, and we've opened for basically every artist that came to the Virgin Islands between the year 2000 and 2003 or 4. And we've gained quite a lot of recognition. And we traveled to St. Croix, which is a sister island. And there I met a producer called Dean Pond, who later on produced my first album, you know. And after that album, that's where I really got the inspiration to leave the island. I got so many great reviews throughout the island, and I was opening shows for every act, every artist that came to the island, whether it may be hip-hop, dancehall, reggae, it don't matter. Like, I was the opening act. Everybody, all the artists that I opened for would encourage me to leave the island. Like,
you're too good for this. You're too good for this.
Yeah, like, you sound real good. You need to leave the island and pursue your dreams, you know. Especially the Jamaican artists, they would always be like, yo, you need to come a yard. You need to come a yard. You know,
you ever go?
And it was never, I was never given that invitation. Like, listen, you need to come check me a yard. You know what I mean? Like, you need for when you come a yard, you need to come look for me, and then we are going to put you in touch to do something. It was like, just come a yard. And I never had that structure. You know what I mean?
You have to go with somebody.
Yeah. So Dean at the time was between living in St. Croix and living in Miami, where he was working at Guitar Center, you know. And Don Carleon used to go to Guitar Center to get a lot of his hardware and software for the computer and whatever he may need. Deal would hook him up with some nice discount and stuff like that, you know. So Dean, of course, helped him out one day with some discount, and in return Dean gave him a CD and said, I would like you to listen to this artist, you know what I mean. And Dan heard the album, and Dan reached out to me, and it was history after that. It was like a dream come true, because I was listening to everything Dan Carleon had put out at the time, like from the Sizzla, you know, Rise to the Occasion, and and Soul Deep from Sizzler and the Vibes Cartel up to the time. It was like he was putting out massive production.
So was that, before you were hooked up, you hooked up with him?
This was before I hooked up with
him. So was there any influence of that in your music? Like his work, anything that he did kind of influenced you and you were reproducing some of that sound also?
Not yet. Right. Because my first album at the time, Meeting Dan, even though I'm kind of like skipping a lot of time in between Meeting Dan and the album coming out, right? But at the time, I didn't know about Dan that much when I released my first album. And then afterwards, I realized, I started to hear the Sizzler album rise to the occasion, and then Vibes Cartel. You know, even when I heard the Vibes Cartel music first, but I wasn't thinking so much of the producer. I was more following the artist, like, yo, that artist, they're bad, you know? But when I started to listen to Sizzler album Rise to the Occasion, I've been listening to Sizzler, but at this time now, the music was different. It wasn't nothing like the music he was producing before, you know? With Vibes Cartel, the artist and the music was new. You know, so it was like I was more focusing on the artist. But with Sizzler and Dan, I was more focused on Dan because it was like, yo, the true name bad, but the producer, who is he? Yeah. So I was like, no, following. And then I was like, oh, he produced Vibes Cartel too? He was doing all of that? So now I'm more into him, like into the music and stuff like that. Yeah. I'm excited. And then he reaches out to me, you know? It was a dream come true because I had much respect for, you know, the King Jammies and, you know, the Bobby Digital, the Exterminator Records, the Star Trail, you know, the Shakin Vibes. I had so much respect for all those productions, but Dan Carlyan was my favorite, you know, at the time. He was indeed my favorite. Like, I wasn't following any producer like I was following him. He was like the Kanye West for me, you know? And him reaching out to me was like, it made the rest of my year, really. The
massive rest of endorsement, my life, isn't it? Massive, you know, endorsement of your time.
Massive endorsement. He reached out and he was like, yo, this is Dan. I was like, oh, Dan. I said, Dan, Dan Carly. And I said, Dan, do this. Dan, oh, produce the drop leaf rhythm. Yo, no, man, I joke this. It was just this excitement.
So what did he say when you were all getting so excited and going off?
No, he giggled. He laughed. He was like, yeah, man, me, Dan Carlyan, man. And he said, yo, I'm listening to the album and love the whole album, yo. It have about 5 songs on the album that I really like. I feel like you're a bad artist and I want to do an album with you too. He wasn't just like, he want to do a song with me. Let me see how it works. He was like, no, I want to do an album with you, yo. So I was like, ready, you know, it's like, oh, let's go. I'm ready. Just let me know what I got to do. Send me the tracks and whatever. So he sent the tracks through Dean, you know. At the time, there wasn't much social media. We didn't even have Facebook, wasn't out
yet. And WhatsApp and all of that.
I mean, none of them things. It wasn't even, it was like BlackBerry just started to come in. You know what I mean? It was a different timing. Flip phone was a thing at the time.
Yes.
You know what I mean? So I drove to Miami. At that time, I was in Orlando. I was the first move I made leaving St. Thomas. I went to Atlanta and then I moved to Orlando. And then I used to travel to Miami back and forth and work with Dean. So I drove to Miami to link with Dean at the Guitar Center. I could remember Dean putting the tracks on in the back of the store where they were selling speakers. They had speakers for sale, so he put it on just to let me hear the music through the speakers. And, you know, it was 13 tracks. I'll never forget. Dan sent 13 tracks for me to start working on. And the first
rhythm. All these are different rhythms, are they?
Yeah, all different rhythms. You know what I mean? And the first rhythm that caught my vibe was the Love and Affection track. You know, I listened to all the tracks and I was like, all right, I listened to Love and Affection. I think it was the second track on the CD, and I listened to it. I played it over again, and then I'm like, listen, I haven't even listened to the rest of the songs and the rhythms on the track.
What are you gonna start with?
Yeah, so I just went ahead, listened to everything. I was like, all right, this song good, but I like this one. Let me start with this one. And I went ahead immediately. I left Guitar Center. I went to another friend of mine's house and I started to write music. I started to write love and affection to the rhythm. By evening time, I actually recorded the song in Dean Pond's studio. And we sent the song to Dan Carleon, and Dan was very excited when he heard it. You know, his response was heavy and he was like, listen, you need to come here. When can you come to Jamaica? I need you to come to look for me. You know, I got to Jamaica. It was probably like 2 or 3 weeks after recording the song. And I re-recorded the song in his studio, you know, and it was history after that. It was like, it was history. It went from like, and I could remember listening to the radio station and people calling in and being like,
who's that?
Yo, pull. They'd be like, pull up that new sizzler, yo, that new sizzler bad. Yo, that Jamaican, that bad. You know,
the new
they were like picking up artists and not me. I was the one that sing the song. They were like requesting, can you play back that new Jamaican? And the DJ would be like, no, that's not Jamaican. That's a new artist named Pressure. And they were like, Pressure?
Pressure.
But they were loving the song. Everybody was loving the song. Undeniable, like everywhere. And the song just, I must say, like the song blew up within weeks. The song was a massive hit coming out of Jamaica. It went from me not knowing what my future holds to me performing every weekend, at least 3 times a week on the weekends for months, years to come. Like, you know what I mean? It was like, whoa.
Hi everyone, this is Shaun Reese, and I'm representing for the Stargazing Show with your boy Shaun Cain, featuring artists from around the world. See? So hit that subscribe button and notification bell. See? I will never break my virgin stone. I know you, Lord, and I will stand my ground. You are the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So the fire keeps blazing. Well read. Stargazing Show.
Yo, a relevant boss I represent for the Stargazing Show with your host, Shaun Cain. No, no, I got ready. Shaun, drop your thing, no man. Oh, I go. Watch it, pray. Boom.
The realest online interview show, Stargazing with Shaun Cain, brings you up close and personal with your favorite stars of reggae and dancehall music and people that have impacted society in a very significant way.
When mama said to me, say, hurrah, it boy, me son, your boss. Me said, no, mama, me only a slow leak.
Join me, Shaun Cain, on the Stargazing with Shaun Cain YouTube channel as we check out the people behind the music. Learn who and what inspired them to write, record, and play some of the biggest records that have changed our lives forever. Find out why they have dedicated themselves to making the world a better place. Come on and let's retrace the mysterious twists and turns of their life journeys and browse some of the most inspirational backstories of all time.
Thank you, God.
We invite you to subscribe to the Stargazing with Shaun Cain YouTube channel, like and share our videos, and leave a comment as we bring you fresh content every week. The Stargazing with Shaun Cain show will inspire, educate, and bring out the best in you. Stargazing with Shaun Cain, up close and personal.
Civ Art Box, I'm there, I present for Stargazing with Shaun Cain, and NOM represent artists' life story, which include joy and pain. You know, check out him YouTube channel fully.
Yeah, you know, and so in my mind, I just know like, okay, this is not it. You know, I need more music. I need to keep creating. I can't let this just, this is not where it's going to end with love and affection.
But how did that, before you move on, how did that make you feel? The success with love and affection and the way people were kind of showing you love and affection, giving it back to you. How did that make you feel?
Big. My pride was out the roof. You know, I felt like I've represented the Virgin Islands well.
Proper.
You know what I mean? Yeah, I felt like I've really made them proud. You know, it was, yeah, I'm being recognized in Jamaica, but I'm being recognized all over the world, you know, for doing what people from the Virgin Islands really usually have, doesn't have such big ambition to be that It's that like people are more locally like trying to become local legends.
The local star.
Yeah, like local star. We have a lot of local stars. But
you were an international star.
Yeah. And
you crossed boundaries and frontiers and borders.
Was a great feeling. Still is a great feeling.
So what did Uncle say about that? Uncle back in
Uncle was happy. Uncle was happy.
Did he phone you up or did he say, did he contact you? I mean, what happened? How did he express that to you?
No, I mean, he downloaded the music. He was very happy and he was proud to see that because he firsthand get to witness that.
Yes.
You know, he got to, and up to this day, I tell this story a million times. You know what I mean? So he's a part of my story forever. You know, if it wasn't for him, I'll be probably trying to figure out about being a drummer, or I'll probably be a top drummer for some band or whatever, because nobody could tell me that I would be an artist. I used to like doing it, singing people's songs, but actually being on stage and having to write my own music, I was not good at writing in school. I was not very good at academics, period. So just having me in front of a pen and a paper was like, that's not going to be me. Just give me the sticks. Let me beat these drums. I don't want to have to think too hard and come up with no lyrics. But it all just hit me.
But do you get tempted nowadays, Pressure, to grab the sticks again? Have you ever?
I have drum set. I have my own drum set here.
Do you play it?
I don't even play it. I can tell you the honest truth. I don't even play these drums at all. They're just there because I'm finishing out my studio and I wanted to be able to lick live drums as well. You know what I mean? So it's there. And from time to time, I pick it up if I want to show off and let people know like I still have a little skills. But usually my nephew, who's the drummer. He went to college and got a certificate for drumming. So he's a drummer for hire and stuff like that. So he uses the drums and stuff like that. He goes with the drums for gigs and stuff like that. You know what I mean? So it's there, but I don't pick up the drums. I pick up the microphone.
So tell me, what happens now after Love and Affection? What was your next big display or the big production that you put out there after
that?
Because you're riding high now, you know, your energy level is high, your motivation level is, hits the roof.
We had Be Free, we had Ghetto Life, you know, we had Bless My Soul put out on under the Don Carlyon Records. You know, after that, I went forward with Dean again and re-released my third album after I did the Love and Affection album with Don Carlyon. My third album, which is coming right back, coming back for you, it was produced by Dean Pond. So I was constantly creating music, you know what I mean? And stuff like that. But I must say that Love and Affection has been put on such a pedestal that, you know, a lot of my other songs and stuff haven't gotten a chance to be heard like that. And being that Pressure has never been signed to any big record label and have any massive budget and stuff like that. And, you know, throughout my career, everything has been independent, you know, and I've been free to work.
Was that your choice or it just, yes, the big offers just didn't come?
Well, I mean, offers have came, but it's like if I want to be locked in a deal and lose my freedom and stuff like that, is like no amount of money could get me to lose my freedom and my creativity. Mm. You know, I'm not going to sign for money to be unhappy because I have money. I love making music and I love the response from the people. I don't want to be able to be making music and be in a position where I can't release this because the record label hasn't recouped from the last project. I want that to be my problem. You know what I mean? Let that be my problem. I haven't recouped from the last album, so what? Next album.
But then as an independent artist, marketing might be a bit of an issue, isn't it? Because you need that marketing muscle to kind of be tossing the music here, there, everywhere, to linking up with radio stations.
It can. It can. So what I do from time to time is during times like this, I hire publicists. Right. I don't have them on a pay list throughout the months and year to year and stuff like that. I hire and select them for projects.
Project,
you know?
Project.
And I work project to project.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I just don't have like a payroll that publicists on the payroll, and you know, it's not like that because I'm independent. Mm-hmm. So I have to work wisely. And you know, I still have my personal life to pay for,
and it is a task.
Mm-hmm. But the great thing is that I have a wonderful fan base who looks forward to everything that I put out and responds well. And they support me and they support the music, and I'm truly grateful for them. You know what I mean? So I always feel like I have to deliver quality, you know, to keep my fans alive, keep them on board, you know. So it's just that for me.
You mentioned a few albums and you were talking about, you know, the Don Carleon project, and then you moved on to, you know, other projects. But then the African Redemption came in. Where did that come from? Why did you feel to redeem Africa?
Well, Africa Redemption, the album itself basically had a cultural effect to it. There was a lot of culture music on it. And lastly, I decided to name the song Africa Redemption, name the album Africa Redemption. And after I decided that, there wasn't a song on the album called Africa Redemption. And then I decided, along with Baby G, like, we should probably create a song and name it Africa Redemption. So that is probably one of the few songs in my whole career that I had a name before I write the song. I would always write, and then the name would come from the song itself, mm-hmm. you know? And even so, coming up with the song, I involved Kranix when in his earlier part of his career, I featured him on the song. And it was a great effect and a great vibe as well, you know?
Mm. But you captured the reggae vibe very well, man. I know you had the music around you in the Virgin Islands, but you captured it so well. When you went to Jamaica, how was it different from the Virgin Islands in terms of the reggae vibe and the way people lived? And
the only difference for me was the way that I dress, because I came to Jamaica in a time when pants start to get tight. Nobody was wearing baggy pants again. So me coming from the Virgin Islands, you know, my pants them baggy. Me, I wear 2X shirt and, you know, size 38 and 40 waist pants. You know what I mean? Like New trendy. York style. You know what
it
I mean?
It wasn't trendy.
Yeah, and it wasn't trending in Jamaica at the time. So, you know, I was at the time, you know, being at Alain was linked with the Don Carleon Records family. You know, she would be like, yo, Pressure, me and you need to go to a store, you know. We need to stop that character.
To go shopping.
Yeah, we need to go shopping, you know what I mean? So that's what we did. We would go out and she would take me to certain store down in Kingston and stuff like that, and we get to find. So that now when I go back to America, I totally changed my wardrobe and stuff like that, and the way I appeared in the market and stuff like that, you know. Just one and two little things. And of course, the food. You know, I've never ate the apple before, the red apple. That was my first time eating that apple.
What was that like?
It was different. You know, it was, of course, not as sweet as a regular apple, but, you know, new flavor, and I loved it, you know.
That's my favorite fruit, man. I grew up on that.
So new flavor, and I definitely loved it. It's something that I always get when I reach yard, and I reach at a stoplight, man. I get a bag,
because they always have bags of them.
Yeah, so I would always get a bag, you know what I mean? Mm. That along with the plums and stuff like that. So, yeah, so there was a difference in the way.
So how about the people? How about the people? Were they very warm? Were they very fast moving? Aggressive, friendly?
I learned a different culture. Of course, I learned that the music is very competitive in Jamaica. You know, it's like everybody is searching for a hit song. It's not just about music. It's like everybody is trying to find that song. And if you don't have that song, you know, you might not get recorded. Like, I learned that from Don Carleon. Like, I've recorded songs for Don. Dan is like, nah, I'm not feeling this, you know. And to me, I love them. I'm like, what are you talking about? But to him, it's not.
It's not going to hit. He doesn't get the feeling it's going to hit.
So, you know, he doesn't just want a filler. He wants a hit. So I've learned that part of the business where, you know, okay, I'm not just going to put anything on record. You know, it has to work while it has to be worth listening to. And it, you know, for some reason, I mean, for the most part, it has to have the hit factor sound, mm-hmm. you know? Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So you kind of work out what has the hit factor sound now? You think you've
well,
got...
Well, I can't tell you I have it all put together, you know, but... You know, I know what people love to hear from Pressure, and I know that when I sing in certain ranges, it gravitates people's attention more, you know. So I kind of know what people, and of course, producers would always be like, look, like when you do so, you know.
So, and do you find that works? Do you find that it works when the song is released, when you do so? And the song is released, it really hits. Do you find that?
Yeah, it works. It works because, you know, it's me, you know, and me give it that to make people love it, you know. It is me I give to the world. So if you say I like this more, then I give that more. Some producers I work with, they have different vibes of what they like from Pressure Busspipe. Some mm-hmm. like me when I'm like, they like the revolution side, the culture side, and some people love the lover's rock side, you know. So it's like whatever fits for me.
So which is your favorite side?
I love the culture side.
You love the culture side.
Yeah, I like to sing the culture music. Mm.
Very good, man. So what's next for Pressure now? What a story, man. What a journey. What's next? I know you have a new album you released very, very recently.
The new album, Heights of Greatness, just released in stores August 27th on all streaming digital platforms. Yeah, it's doing very well. I'm getting so much great responses from it right now. And because of the album, I'm really looking forward to performing and touring Europe and UK and Africa for the 2022, you know? Yeah, and I'm really looking forward for that. This year, I think we're going to acquire some off dates here and there, but we're really putting things together for the 2022 season, the touring season.
It's going to be a big season for you, a busy season yeah. for you. Yes. So tell me a little bit about the album now, a few of the tracks on it and probably what they mean to you.
Well, the album is entitled Heights of Greatness. The album entitles of it has so much different feels. It has songs on the album that everybody could take from and be like, okay, this is what I like, you know. And the feedback from the album as well is like, you know, some people love the love songs more. Some people like the revolutionary songs more, exactly like what I was saying. So that's my reason for putting the album together in that format, because of the response before, you know. You release Africa Redemption and my Lovers Rock fans are like, all right, what you gonna do for us? We ain't hear no love song. You ain't singing no songs like Love and Affection. And then I said, all right. So then I went and I released the album after Africa Redemption, Red Rose, which is Lovers Rock music alone, no culture music. And then my culture side lovers, they were like, yo, you're gonna sing one culture song for it? You're not sing one, you know, so it's always me between a rock and a hard place.
You'll be pulled here and there
When it comes to the music and supplying and giving the fans what they really need. So I was like, this time I'm going to shuffle it and you're going to get it how you want it. You know what I mean? Everybody is going to be able to get what they want from this album. Even if you don't take on to the whole album in itself, there's something that you're going to like and you're going to really like it. You know what I mean? So that was that for me.
Mm. So how could people get in touch with Pressure now? If they see this interview and they suddenly want to go and do some, find out a little bit more about the man. So how about your social media handles? Facebook, Instagram?
Instagram, Pressure Busspipe. Facebook, Pressure Busspipe. Twitter is Busspipe. You know, yeah, I'm the easiest man to find. You know what I mean? It's Pressure Busspipe all the way around.
Nobody else is busting any pipe around the place now.
No, just me alone. Oh, yeah. You know what I mean? Me one.
I like that, man. And I see you've hooked up with Robert Rex. And yes. Wes Rex, you've been doing some work in Europe. How did that come about?
Well, a friend knows a friend, and you know this thing going on. And you know what I mean? People who believe in Iman feel like, you know, Rex is the perfect people to actually put Pressure on the road. So I'm all for it. And, you know, we did our homework and our research and we saw that it's real reputable. So, you know, we're willing to move forward and see what the future brings. But I'm really excited about everything working with Rex Entertainment.
He's a man of action, I can tell you that, man. So you're in good hands. I can tell you that. But Pressure, it was really great talking to you, man. I tell you what, the story is just varied. It's just interesting. It's got all sorts to it. And to understand really that reggae is so big on the Virgin Islands that you could capture the essence of reggae to the extent that a big producer like Don could hear you and say, well, listen, man, come a yard, man. Come on, come do some work done. It's really good.
Yeah, man. That was
a blessing. You get a chance to go back to the islands very often, like to the Virgin Islands.
Man, I travel often. I'm actually on the way there in a couple of days.
So,
yeah, man.
Very good, man. Well, I enjoy every moment of this, man. It's such a good story. And I always like a good story. And the righteousness. I'm always a man for righteousness. And
definitely.
Doing good by mankind. And that's you.
Definitely.
Because always a message to help people to cope better with life. You're not telling anyone to shoot anyone, even though you know how to do it. You know, not to shoot, but how to tell them to shoot people. Yeah, but you don't share that with anyone. You just do that just as your private thing.
Yes.
I respect that, man.
Yes, man. Much love to you.
We have to put righteousness out there, man. So the kids and the younger generations can understand that this is what it is about. Not that.
To the fullest, yes.
And that's creating mayhem. Yeah, that's creating mayhem. We've got to put this. And that bit that you talk about, you know, what you've been appointed by Jack to do what? I'm going to use that because I never thought of it like that. But I know that people should always think about the kind of music they're going to put out there and the kind of artists they are. What do they stand for? What's their value system? But now you said Jazz appointed you. I'm just going to ask them that now. What kind of appointment you think you got? You know, that sort of thing. So yes, thanks very much for that, man.
Much love.
It was really great talking to you, man. I always, before I let you go, always like to challenge my guests to see how much they know about reggae and dancehall music. I always take questions from this book. It's called Reggae Larger Than Life, the ultimate reggae music fun and games book. It's written by myself. It's currently available on Amazon. It's also available in Jamaica at Ashby's Pharmacy, 160 Old Hope Road in Kingston. If you're more into apps, the Android version is available from the Google Play Store. You just need to type in Reggae Larger Than Life fun app. Download it. Have lots of fun understanding the backstory to reggae. Well, to an extent. All right. So I've selected two questions for you, Pressure. I know you're a righteous man, you know, so I thought, you know what? Let me see what we can find. Well, this is all righteousness anyway, because that's what I kind of deal with. So you ready, sir?
Yeah, man.
Are you ready? All right. You're the man. Yeah, man. You know, all the confidence beaming. The man going, bust up the book right now. All right, Pressure. The first question for you says, born in Nine Miles in the Jamaican parish of St. Anne in 1945, this Buffalo Soldier reggae superstar was given a Lifetime Achievement Grammy Award posthumously in the United States in February 2001. Who was he? The options are Peter Tosh, Bob Marley, Delroy Wilson, Dennis Brown.
Bob Marley.
All right, sir. I think the Buffalo Soldier was your clue there. But anyway, let's go on. All right, the next one we've got here for you now is right here. And this one says, this brother grabbed the spotlight when he won the Jamaican talent contest Digicel Rising Stars in 2005. Since then, he has gone on to record several hit songs, including Take My Wings and Baby, I Love You. Can you identify this I'm a Big Deal vocal performer? The options are...
Don't even need to go no further. Just give me Chris Martin.
All right, Pressure. You see, my only the pressure with me now, you know, is I need to find something to make all you love run off your mouth like that, you know. Find something, make it pick out your locks, you know. And, but you know, I didn't succeed this time, but no problems. I know you'll be back, so I'll plan for you next time.
All right, cool.
But Pressure, yeah, man, that's good, man. It's good to see that, you know, your knowledge of reggae is so strong, man. Really good, because if you're an artist, you have to understand what's happening in your industry.
Definitely.
And people around. So that's very good, man. Also, pay your respects to the elders, the people who were there before you, who paved the way, man like Bob Marley.
Almost definitely.
Definitely, man. That's good. So the questions were taken from this book. It's called Reggae Larger Than Life, the ultimate reggae music fun and games book. It's written by myself, available on Amazon. It's also available in Jamaica at Ashby's Pharmacy, 160 Old Hope Road in Kingston. If you're more into apps, the Android version is available from the Google Play Store. Just type in Reggae Larger Than Life fun app. You can download it and you can have lots and lots of fun. So Pressure, it was really good talking to the man. A lot of pressure you put on you today, and you bust up some old bad things, you know, because you've illuminated a lot of people. Let them understand that you don't just do music. You must be on an appointment. And when you come with that appointment, you stick to it. Don't shift. Don't drift, because you've been given that job to do. Go do it.
Yes, man.
So it's really great, man. And we look forward to seeing you in Europe, man. As you say, it's next year still. So, you know, we have to make sure we link up when you come to Europe, because, you know, we link up with Rex, you know, Robert and Wendy.
I would love that.
Yeah, and make sure that, you know, we can have a little chat, man, and all of that. I get to meet the man, you know.
Yeah, man.
Definitely, man. Pressure. So it was really great spending some time, man. Our special guest today was Pressure Busspipe. As usual, remember to subscribe to our channel. Please also remember to like, to share, and leave a comment so we know how we're doing. Until next time, that's all we've got time for in this edition of the show. We'll see you soon. I'm Shaun Cain saying thanks for joining. Goodbye.
Love and life, knowledge was hidden from the wise. Revealed to the babe and the suckling. Heights of greatness, Selassie, I a king and none can reach the level. Born in Ethiopia, that did balance the evil. What a fulfillment in the Psalms 87. Rastaman, you're unconquerable.
Hi everyone, this is Shaun Reese, and I'm representing for the Stargazing Show with your boy Shaun Cain, featuring artists from around the world. See? So hit that subscribe button, that notification bell. See?
I will never break my virgin stone. I know you, Lord, and I will stand my ground. You are the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So the fire keeps blazing. Well read.
Stargazing Show.